Today was a day of remembrance, marking the 40th anniversary of the end of one of America's longest wars. In Ho Chi Minh City, formerly known as Saigon, there were celebrations, including a massive parade marking Liberation Day. The mood was more somber at the American Embassy, where a plaque was unveiled to commemorate Marines killed at the site 40 years earlier. NewsHour special correspondent Mike Cerre, a former Marine who served in Vietnam, brings us tonight's story about a small group of journalists and Marines who returned to the country on this anniversary, remembering one of the most significant chapters of their lives.
Some of the most indelible images of the Vietnam War came during its final hours of April 30th, 1975. After more than 13 years of military involvement, 58,220 Americans killed, along with millions of Vietnamese, it came down to this desperate evacuation of nearly 2,000 Americans and South Vietnamese dependents from the American Embassy compound in Saigon. The former American Embassy here in Saigon, which is now called Ho Chi Minh City, was torn down years ago. It wasn't until 1995, after diplomatic relations were restored, that a consulate was reopened here on the same grounds as the United States' very dramatic exit from what they call here the American War.
The reason I stayed behind is that I'd been there at the beginning, say 1962, and I'd covered it throughout those intervening years. So I felt that I just had to stay behind to see what would happen to Saigon when the communists arrived.
Peter Arnett earned a Pulitzer Prize for his Vietnam reporting for the Associated Press.
The Caravelle Hotel was the center of American network news.
He and other Western journalists have come back to a much different Ho Chi Minh City for the 40th anniversary of the fall of what they knew as Saigon in 1975.
And the Viet Cong would be firing up at the helicopter, so there was a fireworks display every evening.
Many of these veteran journalists thought the eventual takeover of Vietnam was inevitable after the North Vietnamese's Tet Offensive of 1968 in several key cities, closely followed by peace negotiations and the gradual drawdown of American forces starting in 1969. The North Vietnamese took over as much as a third of South Vietnam during their Easter Offensive of 1972.
Well, I see people die almost every day for my eye.
Nick Ott's iconic photograph of a young Vietnamese girl accidentally hit with napalm during the North Vietnamese invasion of the South marked the beginning of the end of the diminishing public support for the war by many Americans.
Right in the beginning, see that picture in the photo, the anti-war everywhere. That just made the war be over.
Only a teenager at the time, Nick Ott was a self-taught photographer who had replaced his photographer brother killed earlier in the war. He covered the collapse of the South Vietnamese army and the mass exodus of retreating military and civilians, all seeking a last sanctuary in the Saigon area in April 1975.
Either me, I don't think Saigon for like next 2 months, maybe they continue for maybe 2 or 3 years.
Photojournalist Nick Wheeler, on assignment for Newsweek and UPI, covered the fall of Ben Hoa, the last major military base just outside of Saigon, and the initial shelling of the city. On the morning of April 29th, the advancing North Vietnamese artillery had shut down the airlift out of Thon Son Nhut Airport, forcing the Americans to implement their backup evacuation plan.
The signal was to be through Armed Forces Network Radio, which was going to be playing "I'm Dreaming of a White Christmas" over the radio. And when we heard that, that meant grab your bag and go to the evacuation point.
Wheeler's bus ended up at the American Embassy, which was besieged by thousands of South Vietnamese, many of them connected with the American war effort. They believed they would be evacuated along with the Americans.
Once we found out we couldn't get in through the gates was to basically just climb over the wall, and then we were helped down and had to jump down on the other side. And once we were in, then it was a very different scene from out on the streets.
Makeshift helipads were created in the compound's courtyard, and atop the embassy itself for shuttling the last of the Americans and Vietnamese who were able to get into the embassy compound so they could be flown to American naval ships standing by off the coast.
We were given the order to fall back into the embassy itself, and then we secured the doors while falling back and looking at these people and looking at their eyes, and you could just see the fear.
Former Marine security guards John Gillian and Bill Newell were part of the last American military unit sent to Vietnam for the evacuation. After the last of the civilians had been evacuated, the last of the Marines waited anxiously for one last helicopter to take them out.
I didn't think it was the Alamo until we sat on the roof for the final 2.5 hours in the morning of the 30th. We didn't know what was going on. All we thought was, this could be the, you know, this could be the final hurrah.
40 years later, Ho Chi Minh City symbolizes the enormous growth Vietnam has experienced since the war and its switch to a socialist-based market economy in 1986. Its growth rate has been averaging better than 6% a year the past decade, elevating it from one of the world's poorest countries during the war to one of the fastest-growing economies in Asia. April 30th in Vietnam is now called Liberation Day or Reunification Day and is a national holiday. Only recently has it also become a show of Vietnam's military power in the region.
April 30, the date is very sad. Everyone, like most of the old people remember, like young people today, you don't know anything. Like my children, you don't know nothing about Vietnam. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Just sad day.
Mm-hmm. Sad day.
Like Black Friday, sad day.
Mm-hmm. For many of the estimated 3 million Vietnamese who fled the country, often at great physical risks and personal hardships, April 30th is called the Day of Shame, or Black April. Given the amount of American blood and treasure lost here over more than a decade of fighting to save South Vietnam from a communist takeover, it's also a day of very mixed emotions for those Americans who served here during the war. Some of them have also come back.
Yeah, I was with the 1st Special Forces Airborne. It's an outcome that we hadn't looked for when we were here. It's not one that we fought for, but we lost, and they won, and now we're partners, and there should be no animosity or living in the past, for Christ's sake.
The last Americans out that day were the Marine security guards. Some of them have come back for this anniversary and to honor two of their fallen comrades, who were the last two American servicemen killed in Vietnam.
I think we need to close the book. And I don't think there's another chapter that needs to be written. I think it's time to close the book.
We're not there to congratulate the communists on their victory. We're there to remember what we did during the war. You know, over 60 journalists were killed, remembering them and remembering the brave American South Vietnamese we covered who fought and died for an idea they believed in.
After the anniversary reunion, Nick Ott will head north to visit the family of the severely burned girl in his photograph that earned him a Pulitzer Prize. She now lives in Toronto, and they speak and get together regularly.
It's quite moving to be actually, you know, on this same ground. In the old days, that the embassy dominated this area. And now, of course, the consulate here is kind of dwarfed by what has taken place in Saigon in the last 40 years.
Perhaps the most iconic images of the American evacuation during the fall of Saigon were not taken at the embassy. They were taken at this nearby office and apartment building, formerly used by the CIA and USAID during the war. It is now surrounded by the new image of Vietnam 40 years later. For the NewsHour, Mike Cerre reporting from Ho Chi Minh City, Vietnam.